In my previous video, I explained how sharpening worked using the Photoshop Unsharp Mask and this sharpening wedge. I also said that the Photoshop Smart Sharpen filter was better than using Unsharp Mask. In this video, I'm going to explain why. I've got the same sharpening wedge open that I had last time. If you want to know how to create this, watch the previous video. I'll put the link in the description below. I'm now going to use the Smart Sharpen filter, and you'll find this under Filters and Sharpen. If I open Smart Sharpen, you can see we've got the box here with the dialog. I can move this around just to zoom in on an area that I want to watch closely. Or I can use this little cursor here and just click on the area. At the moment, this has got some custom settings, and I'm just going to take those back to the default so we can see what's going on. This image here in the preview is set to 100%. I can of course zoom it in, but I've also got the main preview window here set to 200%, so you can see what's going on when I apply sharpening. At the moment there's a noise reduction being applied, and I'm going to take that down to 0 because I don't want it to interfere with the results. I've got the radius set to 1 and the amount set to 200. And you'll recall I said in the previous video, if I move this up, what it's doing is enhancing the contrast along this edge, so that dark grey becomes darker and eventually becomes black, whilst light grey becomes lighter and eventually white. What controls how dark or light the greys are is this amount slider, and it does exactly the same in the Smart Sharpen dialog. The other control we've got that's the same is this radius, and we can use that to make this edge here that we're sharpening actually wider or narrower. Now you can see here that this is actually being created right into the very centre of the image here. Now watch what happens when I change this remove lens blur to say Gaussian blur. It seems to become a lot stronger. Now what's happening here is that when you've got it set to Gaussian blur, it's working in the same way that the Unsharp Mask filter did. When we use the Unsharp Mask filter, we were able to create quite a strong sharpening effect, but it also created halos around some parts of the image. When you're using Smart Sharpening, it actually can reduce the appearance of the halos. So here you can see the halo. Watch it again as I change now to lens blur. It reduces it quite dramatically. Now what's happening is that Photoshop is detecting an edge, and it's trying to restrict the sharpening to the edges in the image. It's not trying to apply the sharpening across everything. So when you use lens blur, there's a sort of masking effect that's taking place in the background. So rather than having a threshold slider where you have to adjust this, you can just rely on the lens blur to do it automatically for you, and it's actually quite good. The other features that you've got in here are reduced noise, and normally you'd have that set to about 10, and all it does is smooths out where some of the noise seems to get enhanced in the image. We've then got this shadows and highlights slider. Now what these do is they allow you to control the areas of sharpening that's taking place, and it gives you a very fine control. So let's take the shadows as an example. When we use this slider, what we're doing is we're saying to Photoshop, detect where the shadows in the image are. And where you detect a shadow, what I want you to do is, rather than sharpen that shadow, I want you to fade the sharpening in that area. And as I increase this, the fading effect on the shadows becomes greater. What determines whether or not a shadow is being faded is this tonal width here. Now when it's set to 50%, it's quite a wide range. If I set it to 100%, it will fade the effect across all the shadows. Now while I've been doing that, if you've been watching down here, I'll just make this a little bit wider so you can see. The effect on the dark side here has actually been greatly reduced, and we're not seeing such an enhancement as we were before. And that's because of this fading amount. Now when the tonal width is set at 100%, there's a large degree of treating things as shadows. If I move this down to very narrow, it doesn't treat as much as shadows, and you can see here we're getting the sharpening effect much stronger now. Watch as I move it up, and it fades it out quite nicely. Now the other control we've got is this radius, and this radius determines how Photoshop detects a shadow. At the moment it's looking at one pixel. Well, typically you don't want to judge if something is a shadow or a highlight based on one pixel. You're going to probably want to be around 10 or 12, and that makes it more accurate. If you make it too wide, what it will do is it will check a wide area and it will detect more shadows than are probably there. So really, something around 10 to 20 is probably good advice for using the radius slider. Now the other sliders we've got here are the highlights, and they work in exactly the same way, so you can fade the effect on the highlights as well. Now while I've been doing that, you've probably noticed we've got quite a good degree of fading going on now, even though we've got a massive radius. Let's reduce the radius back down to something more sensible, and let's reduce the amount down to something sensible as well. And what we've got now is a nice crisp edge. Now you can see here a very faint halo appearing, and that's because we're in at 200%. If I turn the preview off, it vanishes, but it reappears here when we've got the preview on, but it's barely noticeable. And if we're at 100%, as we are here, you can't detect the edge at all, but you can see it's there and quite clear. Let's look now at how this can work when we apply it to one of our images. Here I've got the image open that I want to sharpen. I've already created a layer here to apply the sharpening to, and I've converted it into a smart layer. Now this means that when I apply my sharpening using the Smart Sharpen filter, I can go back into it later and adjust it further if I need to. I'm now going to zoom into the image at 100% and select an area that I want to watch, and I'm going to use this area here with these shrubs and this gravel because it will make for good sharpening, and you'll see why in a minute. Now I'll apply my filter. And the first thing I'm going to do is go back to my default settings. Now this has a low setting for the radius and the amount, and at the moment the shadows and highlights fading is turned off. We're applying a small amount of noise reduction, which is fine for an image like this. It's quite a large image, but it was shot as four separate frames on a Micro Four Thirds camera, so it's a little bit noisy as well compared to today's modern standards. Now to demonstrate this, I'm going to push the sharpening amount quite high. And at the moment, even though I'm pushing it high, you can't see any halos appearing around the grass. Let me show you what it would look like if we used the unsharp mask. And we'll move this to the Gaussian blur. I'll just turn the preview off so you can see the difference. Notice that you're getting white edges around these grasses, and it's making them look a little bit lighter. That is the sharpening halo appearing around the grass. I'll turn it back now to lens blur. And you see immediately that that effect has been greatly reduced. And that is without using either the shadows or the highlights fading. Now I am going to fade the highlights very slightly. I don't want to use a wide tonal range. I'm going to set it at something like 30% because I only want to detect the brightest highlights at the moment. And I'm going to set the radius to somewhere around 14. And then I can fade my sharpening in that area. And I'll do exactly the same to the shadows, even though I'm not seeing any shadow problems. Now looking at the image here, it's actually appearing quite sharp now. I'm just going to increase the radius very slightly because I want to make the effect that bit stronger. I'll pull down the amount so that we're not creating quite as dramatic effect. Actually, the radius there is a little bit high. We'll have it at 1.2. So let's go and have a look elsewhere around the image. If I move up to the top here and the edge where we've got the mountains meeting the sky, it's appearing very sharp, but I'm not seeing an edge that would disturb the eye when it's passing over it. and that effect carries on into the distance, and we're seeing really useful sharpening. If I move the main preview window, you can see we've got plenty of detail in these distant hills now, and they're looking very, very sharp. So actually, that's a very good sharpening effect, and it's a lot better than you'd achieve just by using the unsharp mask. We've avoided halos and we've kept the effect natural, but sufficient to sharpen our image. That's looking good, so I'll now click OK and we've applied those changes. If I wanted to go back in, I could reopen the Smart Sharpen filter by double clicking it here. I can then make any further changes before closing it down. I'm happy with that. I'll go back to my full screen. I can now save that as the sharpened image for future use. I hope you found this useful. I'm Robin Whalley. You've been watching Lenscraft. I'll see you next time for another video.